Hello, I'm Simon Whistler, you're watching the Today I Found Out YouTube channel, and in the video today, we're looking at the truth about whether listening to Mozart actually makes you smarter. Let's get started.
Mozart and your brain. Myth. Listening to Mozart will make you smarter. This myth was popularized by a study published in Nature in 1993 by the University of California at Irvine. In their study, Rausch, Ashore, and Kai gave 36 participants one of three standard tests concerning abstract spatial reasoning. The subjects were exposed to three listening conditions: silence, non-Mozart relaxing music, and a sonata by Mozart. Using the Stanford-Binet IQ test, they claimed that listening to Mozart boosted the subject's spatial IQ temporarily by 8 to 9 points over the other two listening conditions. There are a few problems with how this got spun by the media. First, the researchers' claim was only that it seemed to increase subjects' abilities in certain spatial-temporal tasks. They never said anything about increasing ability anywhere else or in a person's general IQ, as their study was only on the effects of Mozart on spatial-temporal reasoning. The media, of course, proceeded to blow these results out of proportion and say that this study showed that listening to Mozart makes you smarter in general, not just concerning spatial tasks. Yet another problem with the media's portrayal of this is that the results only showed an increase in IQ for about 15 minutes. There is no research to date that shows listening to Mozart or any other music can boost IQ permanently. Now to the problems with the actual study itself and their results. First, they used a very small sample size in this study. That should instantly be the first warning flag that one should wait for further research on the issue before jumping to conclusions or taking the results as fact. When you are dealing with small sample sizes, filtering out the noise from what is actually happening is impossible in most cases. With that in mind, it turns out other researchers have had very little success in replicating the original results. Several research projects have run the exact same study using the exact same methods and implementation of the experiment and found zero evidence of any Mozart effect. That said, a few studies have found some evidence of a Mozart effect. So what's going on here? One team of researchers in 1999, made up of Christopher F. Chabris, Kenneth M. Steele et al., concluded, concerning the mythical Mozart effect, that any cognitive enhancement is small and does not reflect any change in IQ or reasoning ability in general, but instead derives entirely from performance on one specific type of cognitive task and has a simple neurophysical explanation called enjoyment arousal. Enjoyment arousal simply means that if you are enjoying yourself to some extent, you will perform better at certain tasks you are given. On that note, another study showed that listening to Mozart only boosted performance in spatial-temporal tasks in those subjects who enjoyed listening to Mozart, which would explain the seemingly random results various research projects have come up with concerning this issue. To further demonstrate that the cause was enjoyment arousal and not Mozart's music, the researchers read passages from Stephen King novels to the subjects while they performed their tasks. The subjects who enjoyed Stephen King novels showed a boost in their ability to perform the tasks they were given at the same boost level as the Mozart effect subjects. Those who did not enjoy Stephen King novels showed no boost, similar to those who did not enjoy Mozart music. Further research by William Ford Thompson, Gabriella Hussein, and Glenn Schellenberg in 2001 also backed up this claim. In their study, they had subjects rate their moods and energy levels while performing specific spatial tasks. When listening to upbeat Mozart pieces, many of the subjects reported their mood and energy levels increased. Those students who reported that increase also scored better during this time. They were also then tested with a more depressing piece of music playing. Not surprisingly, students' moods and energy levels went down, and so did their results. Once the results were calibrated with mood and energy levels, it was found that it was the mood and energy levels, not the music, that was spurring the increased results. Thus, it would seem that the results are entirely based on whether the subject enjoys Mozart or whatever it is they are listening to while being tested, whether music or simply someone reading a Stephen King novel to them. So in the end, money spent on products like Much of the Baby Genius line or the like by states and parents would be much better spent on music lessons for kids. There is a vast amount of research that conclusively shows music lessons, particularly for children, the younger the better, improves their ability to concentrate, helps their self-confidence, helps their coordination, and seems to boost their intelligence as well, among other positive developmental benefits to the brain. Further, the boost is significantly higher than even the most optimistic of the Mozart effect claims. And best of all, these effects seem to last for years, some of them for the entire life of the individual, and the improvements aren't subtle. For instance, another study done by the University of California at Irvine showed that even just 8 months' worth of regular piano lessons given to preschoolers will increase their spatial reasoning IQ, on average, about 34 to 46% over three other groups that had been given computer lessons, singing lessons, and the final group given no special training. Of course, the reason people probably want the Mozart effect to be true over learning a musical instrument is that listening to Mozart is passive. It takes no work and is generally enjoyable to listen to while doing other things, hence the boost. Learning an instrument and to play music is hard, and it takes an amazing amount of work. But in the end, this particular brand of work has been proven to pay off in spades. Bonus facts. It is thought that learning to play music increases the number of connections within neurons in the brain, as well as creates new pathways throughout the brain. Indeed, MRIs of the brains of classically trained musicians compared to non-musicians showed a significantly enlarged nerve fiber tract, about 10 to 15% thicker between the two hemispheres of the brain. This difference was particularly marked in the musicians that had begun training before the age of 7 years old. It is thought that this enlarged corpus callosum improves motor skills and speeds up communication between the two hemispheres of the brain. Further studies have verified these claims and also demonstrated an increase in connections in the areas of the brain responsible for emotion and memory. Bonus fact 2. The idea that listening to Mozart aids the brain in some way actually goes all the way back to the 1950s. At that time, Alfred A. Tomatis, an ear, nose, and throat doctor, claimed that playing Mozart to certain of his patients drastically aided in fixing speech and auditory disorders, among other things. In 1991, he published a book on this subject titled Pourquoi Mozart, in which he explained he felt that listening to Mozart helped retrain the ear by providing varying frequencies for the ear to perceive. He also felt it promoted healing and aided in the development of the brain. So I really hope you liked that video, and if you did like it, click like below and leave us a comment to let us know what you think. And also check out a couple of our other videos, which are linked to on the screen now, and don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos every day. Thanks for watching.